Considering the subject matter of this video, I just wanted to mention really quickly that the link for the Black Lives Matter movement is still in the description below. If you want to help sign petitions, donate somewhere, or know about any events coming up, then the link is still going to be down there. I'll keep it down there, like, as long as I can, pretty much. So yeah, if you want to help and you don't know how, then click on the description below. Let's talk about a movie involving white supremacists. Is a new film coming from the directors of the movie Cooties, which is a movie I really wanted to see. It looked like a lot of fun. Never got the chance to when it came out, but hopefully now I'm making up for it by watching this film that they also made. This movie's about a little girl named Becky, played by Lulu Wilson, who's had a really rough time in life recently. Her mother passed away about a year ago. She's had to live with that for a bit. She hasn't really completely processed it. And in the midst of all this, her dad, played by Joel McHale, is trying to move forward in life. He has found a new girlfriend who he wants to get married to. She has a kid of her own, and Becky is not very happy about that. They go to this cabin in the woods for the weekend, and she's just run off and abandoned them at one point because tensions are a little too high. Unfortunately, right at that time, a group of white supremacists who just broke out of prison, led by Kevin James, show up at this cabin looking for a key. They have the family hostage in the living room, and Becky is the only one running free, so it's up to her to come in and save her family so that they can live a long, peaceful life. When the trailer for this movie came out, I was interested in it because it's a movie about a little girl killing a bunch of white supremacists. That automatically is like, okay, let's see what that's all about. You know, you never know how a story like that will go, because it's something that you can see happening, but it just depends on the execution. The other thing that was the big takeaway, which is, you know, the obvious one, is that Kevin James was playing a villain. He was playing the white supremacist, the lead one. And, you know, Kevin James is mostly known for comedy. He's a part of the Happy Madison crew. I recently made a video about The Wrong Missy, and I kind of talked about how a lot of the Sandler friends probably won't have an Uncut Gems, like how a lot of people like to claim, like, all right, I can't wait for the David Spade Uncut Gems. Probably not going to happen. Adam Sandler doesn't even have, like, a regular amount of Uncut Gems. But I did mention that this performance might be a good way for him to kind of step away from the more Kevin James comedy stuff and do something a little different. I was really hoping for this movie to be good, even if the Redbox distribution thing was a bad sign, because previously they distributed Capone. Whoops. And this movie is coming out at a kind of awkward time, because it's a time where a lot of white supremacists are kind of being spotlighted, and a lot of them are being more exposed than usual because of the helpful camera on your cell phone. So a lot of people right now, especially in a time like this, don't really want to see a movie like this. I've seen a couple people on Twitter saying, don't glorify white supremacists by having them in their movies. I don't care what kind of context it's in. I just don't want to see them. And I can completely understand that mindset about watching a movie like this. I can also understand the mindset of people being like, you know what, I hate white supremacists so much, I want to see them get brutally murdered by a little girl, showing them as just incompetent. I can also understand that mindset. So I'm not gonna try to act like, you know, one side is wrong over the other, really. If you wanna watch this movie, I'm gonna leave that entirely up to you. If you think it's good for you to watch the movie, then go ahead. If you think, I just don't wanna be a part of that, then you don't have to watch it. It's not completely mandatory. As far as me goes, who can pretty much just kind of watch anything, if you're one of those people like me who just wanna know if it's a good movie or not, yeah, I thought it was a pretty fun thriller. The highlight of this movie is obviously Becky, the title character played by Lulu Wilson. She does a really great job here, who's had a really great career so far. You know, absolutely stealing the show in Ouija Origin of Evil, where she gave a standout kind of performance, having a really good supporting role in Annabelle Creation, and now doing a movie like this. She is really killing it lately, and I'm excited to see where else her career takes her. But in this role, she really captures the essence of Becky, because there's a good family drama to back it up too. I've heard some complaints about people saying, like, this girl walks all over her dad, and that's kind of annoying and unlikable for a character. And I just saw it as like, you know what, that seems kind of natural given the context of the story and the family drama. It's something that isn't so black and white. It's something where each character will have a different reaction to. Joel McHale, who's also really good here as the dad, they have a good chemistry with each other. He's one who's like, hey, I kind of want to just move forward. I found a new girl who's, you know, making me feel loved again. I want to move forward. And then you have Becky, who is young and still hasn't completely processed her mother dying and still hasn't completely moved on, seeing this as kind of a betrayal. And there's, you know, this tension that goes on that was really good, and it kind of got you invested with these characters before it even got started. I will say that I wish there was a bit more of it, though. If I had to complain about this movie in any way, it's just that it is a simple thriller movie by design, but it might have been a bit too simple, like to the point where it feels a little bare bones at first, because we don't really see much of Kayla and Ty, the girlfriend and future stepbrother, in the movie before, you know, shit hits the fan when Kevin James shows up. They show up at the cabin and they have an awkward dinner where it's mostly Becky and Joel McHale doing the talking. And I wish they maybe explored those character dynamics a little bit more interestingly, other than just, I hate them all. Like, maybe there's like some like scene where she talks to the younger brother, see if there's anything going on there. Like, maybe, you know, grow a little bit of a relationship before she just like denounces them when he announces that he's going to propose to her at some point. And also, I wish there was just a little bit more in the beginning to kind of further explain like how Becky is dealing in life currently, because they kind of make it seem like she's just been mad at Joel McHale for like an entire year, which obviously that can't be the case. And you can just like picture in your head, like, okay, I can maybe picture this happening in her life this way. But it's something that the movie should have probably done a better job of establishing, because later when she has to do some crazy stuff, you can make the excuse like, well, she's angry, so of course she's going to get crafty and more violent. But it is one of those things where you could have maybe established that she's doing stuff that normal kids aren't, other than she stole something from a 7-Eleven. Like, oh, like, I don't know if that exactly leads to the amount of lunacy she has to endure later. They open the movie up with a really well-edited, this movie's really well-edited too, where they're transitioning shots from her in school and Kevin James in the prison before they break out. They're like moving the camera in the same ways for each scene. They transition to them really smoothly. But when she's at school, you don't really get a sense of like, is she like popular kid? Like, does she have any friends of any kind, or just silent, closed off? We don't really get a true sense of that, and I wish maybe they explored it just a bit more. It was one of those instances where I can understand a lot of thrillers being more simple. Sometimes simple is better, but in this case, it just felt a wee bit bare bones, especially when it comes down to the villain conflict, and they do a thing where they're after a MacGuffin. It's this key. Now, what this key unlocks, or what this key represents, we don't really find out. There's one vague line where Kevin James just hints at the fact that it's more valuable than like money or anything that you might imagine. And I've heard some people try to compare it to like, oh, it's like the briefcase in Pulp Fiction. And it's like, I don't think that's a really fair comparison at all, because the briefcase in Pulp Fiction, you see it open and you see like the gold glow come at you. And it's understood at that point, like, okay, this is not just ordinary money. It's like something more valuable than that, something that could be attractive to a lot of people. And that's all you really need. Like, the point of Pulp Fiction isn't finding out what's in that briefcase, it's just understanding that it is really valuable. Same thing can be said about, like, the Bad Times at the El Royale, when Billy Lee finds the film negative and he's like, do you know who this is? Do you know how valuable this could be to some people? The point isn't finding out who's on the film reel, just it is valuable, and someone like Billy Lee probably shouldn't have that. In those cases, there's a built-up context supporting it, and you understand their motive in the script. In this movie, it's just, we need the key for something, and then you never find out what it is, and it's just kind of left open. And, you know, I guess it's not important for the characters to find out what it is, but it is a part of the villain's motivation, understanding what it kind of leads to. And when you never do, it's like, oh, well, okay, I guess the key was important, but we'll never know. There's not even like a vague concept for it. Just Kevin James says it's more valuable than you can imagine, and they move on. It's like, a little weak there. But speaking of the villains, a lot of them do a really good job in the roles. You kind of get the sense that Kevin James got stuck with like the knuckleheads of this jail cell, because you have one that's like snacking and they make fun of him because he's fat. So there's an expected kind of layer of incompetence when it comes to him. And then there's this other guy that's just like terrified of dogs and can't even deal when one comes charging at him. And he even at one point like tries to talk with Becky and work a deal with her that for a moment you actually think she's considering. It was a nice thing to have those characters kind of bounce. It could have been just disposable characters, here they are, but they did take the time to give them something, which I liked, especially Apex, who's this really tall actor. I'm forgetting his name at the moment, but I think he was in the first Sherlock Holmes movie too, where he was, you know, the tall guy chasing Robert Downey Jr. He was really good in this movie. He's the best one out of them, I think, because he's a bad guy. He's done a lot of bad things, but he at one point he starts to question a certain part of his ethics. Not all of them, but a certain part of it. And it's like, okay, there's an interesting kind of dynamic here. Kevin James considers these guys his children, calls this huge man his son. So there's an interesting mind game to be had with that character. Now, the thing that everyone is probably wondering is, how is Kevin James in the role? He's a bad guy for once. I don't think he's ever played a villain before. I think this is the first time, and it's something just completely out of his, like, you'd think he would never touch, but he is. Originally, this role was actually supposed to be played by Simon Pegg, but he had some scheduling conflicts. I wonder what movie he was filming that maybe I reviewed a couple weeks ago that required him not to be in this movie that maybe was a little bit better than the one he was in. Anyways, then they got Kevin James to kind of replace him. So I don't think this is the kind of, like, performance that's going to get him into more darker characters. I think this is just, like, a one-time, like, okay, you need me because this other guy dropped out. Okay, I'm here. And although I don't think it's like a performance to run home about, it's not even like one of the best performances of this year, he still does a really good job considering what he has to do. He has to like act composed, he acts like this fatherly figure to these guys, and then, you know, as the movie goes on, he starts to lose his edge a bit because, you know, crazy things are happening that he wasn't anticipating. He did a really good job. I think they utilized Kevin James's acting very well for this character Dominic, and he definitely is intimidating in a couple parts. I think he actually like managed to give off some menace, which is really good. I'm glad that it wasn't, hey, Kevin James is here, but he's acting really bad and he's not right for the character. Like, no, he fits in very well, which is a good plus. And it's just a lot of fun to see this little girl fuck up these white supremacists, just speaking for me. Like, there's a lot of good gore that is utilized in the sequences, a lot of really good ideas of staging these thrilling sequences. So even though the premise is a bit ridiculous as far as, like, a little girl taking on these grown men, like, yeah, right, but when you see it play out, it's like, you know what? I can see it, you know, there's context here to support everything, I can see it all playing out the way it is, and you're not taken out at that point by this simple thriller plot. You're kind of more invested, like, okay, I want to see how she's going to be able to wriggle out of this. There's a couple, like, smaller technical gripes that I kind of had with it, not even really worth mentioning. I had a fun time with this movie. If you, once again, if you don't think this is the movie for you, then, you know, don't watch it. But if you're all in on watching a simple thriller, then go ahead. I thought it was a really fun movie. I thought they did a really great job with the Becky character, and Kevin James was really good. I'm going to give Becky a B. It has a lot of really great gore, a lot of really great sequences, you know, characters that you can understand, and you can understand the drama going on with it, a fun plot to get you through it. As much as I wish there is a little bit more development on certain ends of it, I still had a fun time with this, and I think you might be able to too. But if you've seen Becky, leave in the comments below what you thought of it, and as always, thank you guys for watching. Make sure to subscribe. I'm Jackson Fulcher. See you guys next time.